Prophet Ministries. Glad to have everybody here. Glad to have Brother Josh with us. He'll come and bring the word to us here in a little bit. You excited to be in the house of the Lord?
Yes.
As Sister and I were talking earlier, there's a lot of people got to have the steeples and stuff. We don't have the steeple here. We're just in a building. But as we talk about, the church is not. The house of the Lord is here. That's truly where it's at, and it's in each and every one of us. Just as Jesus said to the people that are asking, when will the kingdom of God come? He said, it's in your midst right now.
Yeah.
It's here and now. So when we know we have the Holy Spirit, we have the kingdom of God living inside of us. Amen?
Amen.
So just praise God for that. Let's have a prayer, then we'll get into some announcements and stuff. Lord, we just thank you this evening, afternoon, whatever you may call it, for allowing us to come together and to worship you, to praise you, to honor you, and to thank you for all that you have done in our lives, all that you are doing now, and all that you are going to do, Lord.
Yes.
Because we know that you are the God of the past, the God of the present, and the God of the future.
Thank you, Jesus.
So we just ask you that your sweet Holy Spirit just come and just take over this service.
Hallelujah.
It's not about us, it's about you. That you do your work in each and every one of us today. You help us grow closer to you, stronger in you, bolder in you, so that we may go out and see your kingdom flourish.
Yes, Lord.
Because we know that we are your children. We know that you love us. Mm-hmm. But we also know that we are the workers in your kingdom.
Mm-hmm.
We're honored by that, Lord, that we're the workers in your kingdom, because we know that inevitably, if you wanted to do it all by yourself, you could.
Mm-hmm.
But you have graced us with the opportunity to worship you through serving you. And we do not take that lightly. We praise you for that, Lord. So, Lord, as we take this time to pray it, to serve you through our gathering today, we just are humbled by that and ask for your Spirit to lead us. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
Hey, we got some stragglers coming in. But God is so good, you guys.
Yes, he truly is all is. The time.
He is so amazingly awesome. We got a few announcements that we're going to go through here real quick. As I said before, first announcement is Brother Josh Stratus will be bringing the word today, so give him a big hand already for that. Next week, my wonderful wife, even though she's struggling with thinking about it when doing it, God's given her a word that she was going to bring last week, but the snow kind of interrupted that, and she wanted to do it in front of people, even though she has absolutely complete stage fright. She'll tell you that herself. But she's going to get up here and give us what the Lord has put on her heart next week. So I am done preaching for the month of February. I'm pretty excited about that. I get 2 weeks off, which is all I'm, but you know.
January,
yes. I'm trying to push it another month. I guess I'm trying to take a long vacation. I don't think I could go that long, though. I love bringing the word. It's an awesome thing to do. Amen. Anyway. With that said, also, February the 5th, we will have our second going out for the kingdom. Pretty excited about that. We did that 2 weeks ago? Or last week? Last week we went and did that. Got to pray for some people. Got to talk with some people. Just awesome things happened during that. And all that really is going out for the kingdom is taking the church outside the walls. Amen? We're here at Breakthrough Ministries. We're trying to be intentional about that at least once a month and going outside the walls and just really telling people about God. Amen? Whether it be praying for them or whatever it might be. And then last announcement is April 21st through the 24th will be the first conference we'll have at Breakthrough Ministries. And I finally got the name on here. It's Holy Spirit Activation, Walking with the Holy Spirit. We all want to walk with the Holy Spirit a little bit more. Amen? That particular conference, as you can see, it's 3 days. It's going to be If I've got it right, Thursday night, Friday night, and then it's going to be a few sessions during the day on Saturday as well, and probably bleed over into Sunday some as far as that goes. Still working on everything, then all the different sessions we're going to have with that. But as you notice, it's going to be heavily intentional on the Holy Spirit. I'd say we'll inevitably have a session just in and of itself on the Holy Spirit, because let's be honest, that is probably out of the three parts of the Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and the Holy Spirit, it's the most mysterious to us. Even though He's the one that's with us in the here and now, He seems to be the most mysterious to the church as a whole. And we're also going to have sessions as far as the gifts of the Holy Spirit, as far as that goes. There's going to be a focus on healing going on in that as well. We've seen many healings already happen in our short little lifespan of Breakthrough Ministries. Amen? So we're just going to see God do His thing in the midst of that, and just see God, see people empowered and equipped to go out and do God's work. Because that's part of Breakthrough Ministries' mission, is in Ephesians 4, where it says to equip the saints for the work of ministry. Amen?
Amen.
That's what we want to do. We want to equip people to go out and see Jesus talked about. I'm going to go out on a limb and say, see Him talked about more outside the church building than inside the church building. Would that not be an awesome thing to see?
Yes.
That would be an awesome thing to see, to where He is truly mingled into every part of our lives. So many people try to separate Sunday morning from the rest of their week, but Jesus is 24/7. Amen?
Yep.
Anyway. That covers all the announcements as far as those go. Tithes and offerings as far as going with Breakthrough Ministries. If you would like to sow into our ministry, there's three ways you can do that. Number one, you've got red buckets. One is sitting there and one is sitting back on the table. If you want to put in those if you're here. Also, you can mail it to 436 Yellowhammer Road, Columbia, Kentucky, 42728. That is our treasurer, Teresa's address, and she will get that taken care of. And also, we have a Cash App, cash.app/$Breakthrough42129. If you prefer to do an online giving, that will go as well. Again, I think that covers everything. If you are new to Breakthrough Ministries, we do have a sign-up sheet back there, so you can kind of keep up with the events and everything going on with Breakthrough, whatever's happening. If you'd like to put your name and all that on, I promise we won't spam you and do all those calls of 10,000 you get a day. I know I do anyway. Promise we won't do that. We'll just let you know about things going on here and weather situations, stuff like that. That's what we use that for. So praise God for all of that. Amen?
Amen.
So let's have another prayer, and then the girls will get up here and lead us in some worship. Amen? Lord, we thank You. We praise You again that we're able to be here. Lord, just excite us in You. Lord, I just ask for that spirit that was upon David when he was dancing in the streets, Lord, for joy for the ark coming back to him. The ark of the covenant coming back in for that happening. Lord, put that spirit upon us today that we're just so excited to be worshiping You, to be in Your presence. Lord, it's so amazing to know that we get to serve the Creator of the universe in You. So Lord, just let us worship through You, in You, and for You. In Jesus' name, amen.
Won't y'all stand up with us if you're able, and let's worship the Lord. So glad to see everybody this afternoon.
Thank you. Thank you. If you can feel it, somebody testify. If you believe it.
Hallelujah. Have you felt the presence of the Lord already?
Yes.
Praise God for what He is and what He does. Amen.
Amen.
Well, I'm not going to stand up here and say a lot. I'm just going to let the Holy Spirit keep flowing and just ask Brother John, come on up here and give us the word you got for us that the Lord is giving you. Amen. Look at wherever you need to.
All right. Praise the Lord.
Amen.
It's good to be in His house today. It's good to be with His people. And I'm just excited because, listen, we serve an awesome God today.
Amen.
And I'm just so thankful for every blessing, everything that He's done for me and my family, everything that I've seen Him do in our church family. He truly never ceases to amaze me of His goodness. And I appreciate those songs because, you know, God has so much to offer us if we will just receive it today.
Amen.
And God has a way of showing us things that we thought we already knew. And, you know, one of the biggest hindrances that I think people face is having their own ideas and their own thoughts of what they think is best. When the truth of the matter is, God knows what we have need of more than
Amen.
We do.
Amen.
God created us. We didn't create ourselves.
That's
and
right.
So He knows exactly what we have need of, and He knows exactly how to give it to us and when we need to receive that. And so we need to activate our faith and just receive all of His blessings and His goodness. I'm thankful today. I'm going to turn in front of the screen. Sorry about that.
Oh, you're fine.
I'm out of Rome everywhere, so I'm sorry.
You're fine.
I'm a roamer. But I'm just excited to be here. I'm thankful for this opportunity. I want to tell you that we serve an awesome God, like I said. And I just am thankful for the opportunity to get to listen. The Lord has been, well, let me just rewind a little bit further than that, a little further. The Lord has really been dealing with me the past several months about different things. And the Lord is actually, and please, I'm not boasting. I don't want you to perceive that. The Lord is walking me through a new anointing.
Amen.
I tell you, to be honest with you, I don't know how to handle it. And I'm working through that myself. But God has called me to evangelize more. And when God asks you to do something, He'll make a way for you to do it. And
yes.
So, yes. I mean, He spoke to me very clearly this coming year, you're going to be evangelizing more. You're going to be going out more and doing more and preaching more and going to different places. And it wasn't but just a few days, Brother Adam sent me a message. Because I was like, God, okay, I'll do it. Because I thought, how am I going to do that? I work full-time, pastor of church, and I was like, we got family, and we got ball games, and we got all this stuff going on. I was like, how in the world is this going to be? And I was like, okay, you know what? Why am I letting the devil get into my head? I'm like, okay, Lord, if it's what you want, I'll say yes. Well, days, Brother Adam sent me a message, would you come and minister? And so I have been to other churches in the past 2 weeks several times. I got a phone call just about 2 hours ago. Could you come to Glasgow to preach at our church tonight? Yes, I can. I will. So praise God. So you know, when He speaks something, you also confirm it.
Amen.
So I was like, God, just open the doors, whatever you want to do. But listen, I want to come today to just speak life over this church body.
Amen.
And just speak encouragement to you all. Because listen,
Amen.
What we need to hear today is encouragement.
Yes.
We really do. We need to encourage each other. We are not in competition against each other.
Come on.
That's not what it's about at all. And you know, that's been one of my pet peeves forever, is churches are fighting against each other. Listen, the devil don't have anything to worry about if we're too busy fighting each other ourselves.
Come on.
I mean, that's just the truth of the matter. We're on the same team, folks.
That's right.
And we got to start working together, and we need each other's prayers and support. And I pray that I can come do that today. And I'll just tell you, I have wrestled with the message today. Last week, I had the message. God give it to me. And it was coming from the book of Acts, and I was like, okay, I know that's it. And so anyways, this morning at our church, I preached a message on renewal, and I was praying after church for the service today, and I was looking at the other scripture in the book of Acts, and I was preparing for it, and God just says very clearly, very plainly, renew. I was like, Lord, okay, we did that. And he's like, renew, renew. And so I was like, God, I thought you wanted me to preach out of Acts. And he was like, I did. I told you that. And I was like, okay. I'm totally confused. So I'm just going to follow the Holy Spirit. Sometimes I get a little derailed and I chase a rabbit or two. Y'all rope me back in if I get too carried away.
We like rabbits around here.
But listen, all I know is, to preach the other message, I just may have to make arrangements sometime to come back or something. I don't know what happened. Well, we'll figure that out later. But anyways, I do believe with all my heart that God wants me to speak renewal over somebody's life. Maybe everybody here today through the Word of God. So if you have your Bibles, or you're going to have it on here, whatever, however you do it, I don't know. Listen, paper Bible, electronic Bible, stream Bible, we're going to read the Bible, okay?
Amen.
All right. 2 Corinthians chapter number 4. And I'm going to begin reading in verse number 13. And we're going to read together here. That's so fancy. All right. I love that. All right. Y'all ready to go? Anybody ready?
Yes, sir.
Y'all ready?
Amen.
Yeah. All right. 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 13. The Bible says, we having the same spirit of faith, according as it is written, I believe, and therefore have I spoken. We also believe, and therefore speak, knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus, and shall present us with you. For all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might through the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. Hallelujah. For which cause we faint not, but though the outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. For our light affliction is but for a moment, worketh for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. While we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. Father, I thank you for your word today. I ask again, God, release your anointing in this house, God. I pray, God, that you would give us ears to hear, hearts to receive. Speak to us with boldness and clarity. God, move with your Holy Spirit across every heart, across every mind, under the sound of my voice right now. And I pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God for his word today. This is so convenient. Y'all just uptown. Y'all just got it going on. I praise God for his word today, no kidding. Because his word is good. I want you to know that the Bible is a living word.
Yes.
And the first thing that I want you to know is the word is living. And if we read John 1 verse 1, we'll understand that the word of God is the Lord himself. And so his word is alive. God is alive.
Yes.
God was alive and God is alive. God is very much alive in our midst today. And like you said, the third person of the Trinity, oftentimes we don't give the Holy Spirit enough credit as I think that we should, because it's not as easy to understand or comprehend even. But I want you to know that I'm thankful for the Holy Ghost that's in this house today. If you can't feel his spirit, might I check yourself, because he's in the house today.
Yes.
But I'm thankful for that. But I want you to know that God is still very much alive, and God is still very much not only alive, he's still very much active in our lives. God is not only just in existence, he's active. And the thing about God is, a lot of times we talk about God as being in some faraway place, a million miles away, that is unobtainable or unapproachable or not even in our midst at all. It's kind of like when you go to a museum and see something on display in a case or something. He's alive and he's there, or an animal in a cage, but we can't get full access to him. And that is strictly Satan. And he wants us to know today that he is alive and he's very much active, and he will be active on our behalf if we'll fully submit to him and ask him to be. Not only will he be, he wants to be today. He wants to fight our battles for us. He wants to give us good thoughts. He wants to go before us in everywhere that we should go, in every way that we should go. So I want to tell you this, that God is never tired. God is never exhausted. God is never worn out. God does not sit in heaven and be like, oh Lord, it's them again. That's not him at all. Matter of fact, he desires for us to have intimate fellowship with him and commune with him through prayer. And he wants us to be in a relationship with him so much so that he give us his best gift of Jesus Christ when he come down from heaven and come into this imperfect world for an imperfect people and did all the things and lived a perfect life and willingly give up his life so that you and I may have eternal life with him forevermore. That is how much he loves us so. He cares about us so much so that he did not write us off as an accident or a mistake. Matter of fact, the Bible says we are not a mistake at all. It says that we are created in the likeness and in the image of God. The Bible tells me in Jeremiah that he knows the plans that he has for me, and they're good plans, plans to prosper me. The Bible tells me that he died to give us life, not only life, but an abundant life.
Come on.
And that life is accessible to us. It's not a million miles away. Listen, Jesus told his disciple, he said, it is expedient that I go, because if I go, I'll send the Holy Spirit, the Comforter, to you. And listen, that same Spirit, as we read just today, is a working in our midst right here. It lives on the inside of us if we are a born-again believer. And the very same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead is active in our lives if we will just access what is already here and take advantage of the Spirit that lives on the inside of us. Listen, there is power in the Holy Ghost today.
Amen.
There is power in our Savior. There's power in the Word. And there is power in our thoughts and in our minds. And I could go a million different directions with that. But listen, we as a people of God have to think about what we are thinking about.
Come on.
Amen.
The Bible tells me in Proverbs that death and life are in the power of the tongue.
Yep.
And whatever's here and whatever's here, the Bible says out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. Yep. Mm-hmm. So whatever is in here, eventually going to come out here. Mm-hmm. Like, okay, we go to church and we'll put on our best duds and we'll brush our hair and clean our teeth real good and get our breath smelling nice and we'll hug each other and tell each other we love them and everything else, and then we'll go right back out the doors and live this CEO way there is and everything else, and everything is really falling apart. Listen, God knows the intents of our heart.
Right.
He knows our hearts. He knows our thoughts. He knows our motives. He does. He knows who's calling on him in a sincere heart. He knows more than we know, church.
Come on.
So what I'm saying is, we may be able to fool a lot of people and go through the motions a lot of times, but if there ever was a time to push the act to the side and say, God, I'm a mess. Listen, there's no shame in it. We all a mess. The Bible tells me that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And we have all made mistakes. And we are all born into sin. And if it weren't for Jesus, we would have no hope today.
That's right.
And so I'm thankful for that. And I'm thankful. The Bible says that he is faithful and just to forgive us. Hallelujah. That means when we make mistakes and we make a big mess out of things, when we may even try to start doing the right thing and we make a mess out of it, guess what? He picks us up every single time.
That's right.
And we have to be the people of God that loves God more than anything else. And we got to love people. Because that's what the new commandment Jesus told us in the New Testament. He said to love God with all our heart, all our soul, all our mind. Love your neighbor as yourself. Love God first and foremost. Seek ye first the kingdom of God and his righteousness. Mm-hmm. Everything else falls into place when you do that. I'm not saying that it's going to be a perfect life. I'm not saying you're not going to have trials and tribulations. Matter of fact, the Bible says many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers out of them all. Hallelujah. Aren't you glad of that? Okay, so it's not going to be a perfect life. It's not going to be a tiptoe through the tulips kind of thing, or walk through the roses, or whatever thing else. But listen, the reason is not because our enemy, the adversary, the Bible says, is as a roaring lion.
Yes.
He's going to and fro. He's seeking whom he may devour.
Yes.
And I want to tell you, church, that we are living in such a time when if we are not spiritually sharp and grounded in this word right here, he'll devour us.
Right.
It's time for us to get into the word more now more than ever before.
Come on.
It is.
Amen.
It is time to get into the word so much so that it ends up coming out in our everyday lives. We should be a people of God that loves God ultimately and supremely and loves people. Listen, I share this with my church, our church, all the time. We're not going to win souls. And we're not going to build the kingdom of God. Let me rewind it a little bit. How can I put this and not be so offensive? We're not going to win souls by going to the... Because we talk about evangelism and we talk about being a witness. You know, he gives us the Holy Spirit to be the witness, right? And we are to be witnesses for Christ. But we are not going to win souls by meeting people in the parking lot and into Walmart and into Dollar Store, beating them over the head with a Bible and pointing out everything they ever done wrong in their life. That is not evangelism. That is not how we're going to win souls to the kingdom. Matter of fact, we're going to do just the opposite. We're going to run people far away from us as they can get. Be like, oh God, there's irreligious people. I got to, I think I got it. Back. I like in the Old Testament, they say, unclean, unclean. That's not how we're going to win souls, and that's not how we're going to build the kingdom. We got to love God, and we got to love people. That means we got to love each other. With churches has got to love churches, okay? And guess what? Churches has got to love lost people. Listen, they know what they're doing is wrong. They know their mistakes and their failures. And the last thing they need is somebody point a finger in their nose saying, you did this, you're going to hell. Now, I believe in preaching heaven, and I believe in preaching hell, and I believe in preaching the word, and I believe in preaching Jesus. Listen, people say, well, are you a kingdom preacher? Are you a prosperity preacher? You preach about money, offerings. You say, well, he's a prosperity preacher. Listen, I'm a Jesus preacher. Because in this world, this is what I preach. People are so worried about sticking a label on somebody and putting you in a category. Listen, we got to be followers of Jesus, period.
Amen.
Okay? All right. Now, where was I? We got to love people. Lost people, they need to be loved. We need to be able to go up to lost people and look at them and say, listen, I don't know exactly what all you're going through, but God does.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
And I want to tell you what, I'm going to pray for you, and God loves you. No matter how far you think you are away from Him, He loves you. Matter of fact, He loves you so much that He gave His one and only Son for you. Mm-hmm. And He gave His life for you so you may have an eternal life with Him. Guess what? And we speak life over them. You know what we do? As church people. You know what we do? They ain't never going to straighten up, I can tell you. They always been that way. Meaner than the devil. They ain't getting no better. You know what we're doing? Remember what I said in Proverbs says?
Mm-hmm.
Death and life are in the power of the tongue. So if we're speaking doom and gloom over them lost people, guess they don't need that. They don't need that at all. But I tell you what this world needs. The world needs some people that loves God with all their heart, soul, and mind, and loves people and has compassion on the people. One of my favorite things in the New Testament is when Jesus was, he had been teaching all day long, and he took the boat and he went around. He was exhausted. The Bible says there was a whole multitude of people that run on foot on land to go around to where Jesus was going to. And the Bible says when Jesus come up and he saw that multitude of people, this is one of my favorite things to read. He said, he didn't say, I'm tired. I've been doing this all day. I'm exhausted. The Bible says he looked on those people because they wanted just a little more Jesus. We should live like that, church. We should live our lives in such a way, I need just a little more Jesus. I've not met any person, any preacher, any teacher, any worship leader, anywhere that has finally arrived. I haven't. We should all live our lives in such a way where we desire to be a little closer to Jesus than we were yesterday. Because the truth of the matter is, Jesus is coming, and I believe that the signs of the times, I mean, you don't have to be a spiritual person to look in the world and say, you know, something is going on. You don't have to be very spiritual at all, but the signs of the times are all around us, church. And if all you have to do is look and see, Jesus is coming soon.
Yeah.
Well, people's been saying that for years. They've been preaching that all my life. Listen, we're one day closer today than we was yesterday.
Right.
And our heart's desire should be, Lord, I need to be a little closer to you today than I was yesterday.
Yeah.
That should be the desire of our heart. So we got to be a people that loves God and loves people unconditionally. Period. But sometimes, now I'm going to be honest with you. Sometimes we get tired. And we get discouraged. And we get to a place to where we're just not as enthused about serving God as we once were. You remember how it was when you first got saved? I mean, I do. I couldn't wait. I couldn't wait. The next morning, I got saved at night. And the next morning, I was going up to people that I work with. And I was like, guess what happened to me last night? You ain't never gonna believe it. And you know, I went to people that I knew went to church their whole lives. And I thought I would find encouragement. You know, I got answers like this. You mean you wasn't saved already? No. Not sure now that I should be. No, but I'm serious. But sometimes we go along to get along so much so that we don't even realize that we're getting numb to the Spirit of God on the inside of us, and that we're getting numb that we're still living in a world that is lost and dying and hurting and bleeding out. And we have the power of God in us through the Holy Spirit to speak life over those that are lost. We need to speak life over each other, and we need to speak life over those that are lost and undone today. So, and that's what I wanted to talk about today. Actually, that's what the Holy Spirit wanted me to talk about today, is that we need to be come to a place in our relationship with God where we need to say, you know what? Every now and then, we need just to be renewed, revived, refreshed.
Yes.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
Because we can almost get to the point of burnout.
Yeah.
I mean, we really do. We almost get to the point. You know, I was talking to a pastor today on the phone, and he was sharing a story from the Bible with me. And it got me thinking about it. So I went back and I read that story, and it's found in Mark's gospel, and it's the story when Jesus calms the storm, you know? If you read it in the gospel of Mark, he says that the wind was blowing against them, and the water was beating against the ship. And the Bible says that the ship became full when the water was beating in on it, so much so. Then they went to Jesus and woke him up. Now, I'm not the smartest, sharpest knife in the drawer. But if I was in a boat, I believe I would ask for help before it got plumb full of water.
Mm-hmm.
Right? Right? But really, that's how we are. When negativity comes in, when resistance comes in, because listen, the devil's going to be mad that you come to church today. He's going to be mad that you read his word today. He's going to be mad that you're doing things for him. And the more that you do for God, the more resistance he's going to throw your way. I mean, I'm just being honest with you. A new level means a new devil. I mean, he's going to bring it up a notch. And I mean, you're going to have to fight that much harder. And I'm not saying that to discourage you. I want to encourage you today. But what I'm saying is, don't wait till you're already burnt out before you say, Lord, I can't do this anymore. There's no shame in saying, ooh, this is getting tiring. Well, there's some water coming in. I got some resistance. Okay, we're going to get with it here. I'll help y'all catch some rabbits sometimes. Whew. All right, knowing that he which raised up the Lord Jesus shall raise up us also by Jesus, and shall present us with you for all things are for your sakes, that the abundant grace might... Hallelujah. Aren't you glad that we have abundant grace?
Yes.
Amen.
I mean, not just a little dab of it. God loves us so much, he gives us abundant grace. Hallelujah. Might towards the thanksgiving of many redound to the glory of God. Church, we should be in a place in our spiritual walk where we are seeking God's glory. Not so we can have fairy dust on us when we go to the Walmart or go out to eat somewhere, but we should seek God's glory in such a way, say, God, I want you to work through me and let others see you in me. Listen, we don't have to hold a sign over our heads. You know how we're going to witness to people effectively? Live our lives in a way that is pleasing to God. And when you love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and you love your neighbor as yourself, you don't have to have flashing lights. You don't have to have a sign. You don't have to have any of that stuff. People will see that there's something different about you than everybody else. And people will see that, and people will take note and be like, you know what? They seem to always be joyful. They seem to always be loving. They seem to always be kind. And when we are exercising and walking in the fruit of the Spirit as God desires for us to do, then guess what? You don't have to do anything but live your life for God.
Yeah.
That's how we're going to witness. That's how we're going to win souls. Not beating them down. Okay. Verse 16. We've got to get to going here. Can we put 16 up here? Can you go back up? Because it got reverse.
Come back that way.
It's okay if you don't.
Yeah.
Wrong way, Kim.
Yeah. Yeah, right here. Let's just hang on to this one for a second. So the Bible says this. For which cause we faint not, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed day by day. The Bible says our inward man can be renewed day by day. And I believe if there ever was a time for the church, and I'm talking about believers, not just the denomination or independents or anything. I'm talking about the born again children of God. If there ever was a time for us to be renewed, it's right now. If what I'm saying is, if there ever was a time for us to get on fire for God, that time is right now. If there ever was a time for us to witness more, it's right now. If there ever was a time for us to love more, it's right now. If there ever was a time for us to preach more, it's right now. If there ever was a time for us to be who God has called us to be even more, that time is now. If there ever was a time for us to get into this book more, the time is now. We don't need to wait and put it off and be like, well, I'm going to wait till this happens or that don't happen or whatever else. But listen, we are being renewed, and so many times we don't even realize we're being renewed because we're too focused on the things that's on the outside to focus on the things that's on the inside. God wants to renew our strength. The Bible says He's a renewer of our strength. The Bible tells us He renews our spirit. The Bible tells us He renews our days. The Bible tells me that He can renew our youth. I believe that He renews our youth in a way such as this, because I don't think that He means to turn us into a wild heathen teenager again, but I think He wants to renew our youth in such a way as this, because so many times we get in such a routine and such a rut that it just doesn't feel the same to us when we come to church and worship. We just go through the motions, and I say it like this a lot of times. We punch our spiritual time clocks, and we punch them out when we leave. And then it's just, well, I don't know. What I'm saying is this. I'll get to the bottom line here. We come to church and we leave church the same way we came. That shouldn't be.
Come on.
We should come to the house of God and say, Lord, I made a mess this week or whatever happened. But Lord, I know You're going to pick me up. And guess what? He's sitting there waiting with arms open. He's not in heaven with a fly swatter fixing to beat you down. He's saying, come on home, my child. Come on home. Welcome home. Let me pick you up and set you on your path again. He'll do it every single time, church.
Yes, yes.
What I'm saying is this. If there ever was a time for us to be renewed, that time is now. The Bible says He renews our mind in Psalms 51. He renews our mind. Listen, if there's... I don't have time to talk about all this. But if there ever was a time for us to think about what we're thinking about, that's now. Satan has a field day. Right here.
Right.
A lot of times, we worry about what everybody else thinks. We worry about what this one's going to say. We worry about this, and we worry about all this in our mind. The true battleground for spiritual warfare is right here.
Come on.
In our mind. It is, and it is a battleground.
Yes.
That's why the Bible says we have to take every thought captive. Okay? And thoughts come in. And sometimes you can't control the thoughts when it comes in. But when it comes in, you've got to get a hold of that thing and say, not today, Satan.
Yeah.
No, I'm doing away with this thought. I'm putting it down. This is not of God. This is not what you want me to dwell on, because what we feed on is what we turn into. Okay? And we need to feed on the Holy Spirit and God's Word. Right? Okay. He renews all things. Matthew chapter 19 says that. He's the God that renews all things. That's what Jesus said. So what I'm saying is, he can renew everything. He can make everything new. And he does make everything new. But the thing is, renewal begins right here on the inside. Okay? Though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed. The inward man is renewed. So take, for example, if you have a vehicle, a car or a truck or whatever you want to call it, and that thing, looking on the outside, it looks, I mean, not a scratch on it, shiny, nice, everything looks new, everything looks great. And then you pop the hood and there ain't no engine in it. That's how a lot of people are when they come to God's house. They look the part, they act the part, but on the inside, they're falling apart. And the truth is, there is no condemnation and there's no shame in bringing your broken heart, pouring it out at the altar at God's house, because we're too worried about what Sister Susie or Betty Sue is going to think if we come up there and we say, "Lord, I made a mess 6 weeks." They're going to say, "Well, I knew she had a problem for a long time. Now I just tell you, they ain't been acting right." But we got to stop thinking like that and start getting real with God. Now listen, if there ever was a time for us to get serious with God, it's now. And say, "God, this is a mess. My heart is broken and I pour it out to you." And we should be mature enough in the faith to be able to pray for our brothers and our sisters and encourage them and lift them up and say, "God has got this. God has got you. Don't you let that devil come into your mind. Don't you let that devil come into your heart. You can let go. Because he is renewing you from this day forward. You don't have to leave this church service the same as you came in today."
Come on.
That's how we should be. We should get a tenacity about it and say, "Devil, no, not today.
That's right.
It begins on the inside. On the inside. The Bible says in the book of Isaiah, he says this in chapter 43. He says, "Behold, I will do a new thing."
Come on.
Hallelujah. "I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness."
Yes.
That's what the word says. "And rivers in the desert." Hallelujah.
Come on.
So let me ask you this, and be honest with yourself, and you don't have to raise your hand or draw attention to yourself or anything else, but just ask yourself this question. Have you ever found yourself going through a spiritual drought or a dry time? Because I know I have bunches of times. I mean, not just every now and then, just a bunch of times. I feel like, "Lord," this would be me praying, "Lord, I feel like I'm preaching and there ain't nobody listening. And I feel like you're giving me these words and ain't nobody receiving them and all this." But at the end of the day, if we do what God has asked us to do, it's not our position to say how it's going to turn out.
Come on.
Because our words are seeds.
Come on.
Seeds go into the ground. Okay? Mm-hmm. So, for example, we were driving somewhere the other day and we was looking out. I don't remember where we were going, but it was cloudy and doomy and gloomy. And I made the comment to Tanya in the car. I said, "Shoot, gosh, look at all these dead trees. There ain't a green leaf nowhere. I mean, it's just dead looking." But you know what looks dead on the outside? Sometimes God allows us to go through dry, desert, dead seasons in life to prepare us for the new life that is to come. To prepare us for the new season that we are approaching. Because listen, you can go out there today and look at all them dead trees and think, "Yeah, it is depressing. It's cold. It's gloomy. It just ain't no fit time to be going nowhere or do nothing. And it's just humdrum and everything else. But the truth of the matter is, in just a couple months, 2 or 3 months, listen, you're going to go out there and them same trees is going to have new life coming out of them. Because the truth is, our words are seeds. And the death and life are in the power of the tongue today. And so if we speak life, we are sowing seeds of life. And listen, just as you sow a seed in a pot or in a garden or anywhere else, a greenhouse, whatever you may have, you may not see any evidence of a change today. You may not see any evidence of something different tomorrow. You may not see any evidence of something happening 2 weeks from now. But I can tell you one thing, the seed is sown. And if you will just be faithful and you'll be obedient, one of these days you're going to see new life coming where there used to be death. Because God will use a dry season to bring life into a new season. And that's what He's going to do, is to renew us to a point to where we are walking in a new season. Listen, church today is not what church was 5 years ago. Just the whole world isn't.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
It's not. And it's put a strain on pastors and stuff. I've been at the church, Church of God, been pastoring there for, it's been 8 years. And it doesn't seem like it's been 8 weeks. Like, how? What happens? I mean, Sam's growing up. I'm like, how does this happen? But the truth is, it happens. And what are we doing? And we have to treat things differently today than we did yesterday. That's why He prepares us and brings us into new seasons, because there's new things that He wants us to do and new places He wants us to go.
Yep.
I want to tell you this. The Holy Spirit will help us to focus on the slow progress that's happening, the slow renewal that's happening right here. The Bible says day by day. Okay? And sometimes, listen, we like to jump when we start preaching on the Holy Ghost, and we like to snort and stomp and run and roll on the floor and all that stuff, and that's fine and wonderful. But we also have to understand that sometimes the Holy Spirit comes on us so softly and subtly.
Mm-hmm.
And we have to understand that the Spirit is doing a work on the inside of us. Mm-hmm. And we like things quick. I mean, microwave. Beep, beep, ding.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. That's how we... Like, we'll pray. We did our Sunday school lesson this morning. Was talking about how Daniel fasted for 3 weeks and he didn't see any results till the end of his fast. But what I'm saying is that we got to figure out that the Holy Spirit is doing a work on us even when we don't realize He is. He's renewing us day by day. And we want to be monsters and giants in the faith, and that's wonderful and that's great, because we should all desire that. We should all desire to be more rooted and grounded in the faith and more spiritual than we were before. That should be all of our heart's desire, because you can't say, I'm going to get closer to God, but I am getting closer to the Holy Ghost. That should be our heart's desire, to get closer in the spiritual realm. Because listen, the battles we fight today are spiritual battles.
Come on.
Now, I could preach forever on that. Ephesians 6:12 says, for we wrestle not against flesh and blood. But it tells us that we fight and war against things called powers and principalities and rulers of darkness, spiritual wickedness in high places. We read that and we don't often apply it to our life. I don't know if we think it's for somebody else. Listen, it's for the church.
Yes.
Come on.
It's for us.
Yes.
But the Holy Spirit will help us to focus on the inward renewal. It will prepare us for the next season. Isaiah said that those streams would flow, rivers in the desert. He would make a way in the wilderness. That's how we need to be living our life, church. Focusing on that. Because we look for the spectacular, the miraculous, the instant. But what we don't often look for is the slow change and the slow spiritual growth that's on the inside of us.
Mm-hmm.
And that's what we need to focus on. And listen, we should all, like I said, we should all want to strive to be monsters in the faith and super spiritual. We should be. We should be able to go lay hands on people and watch God move. I'm serious. We should pray for our boldness to be able to do that. And we should pray for the Holy Spirit to move through us, to have the power to do it. Guess what? Jesus did greater things, and you also did.
Come on.
Okay? So we should pray for that. We should pray to be more spiritual. But listen, 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 listen. We will never, ever be more spiritual than we are scriptural. So if you want to get closer in the spirit, you better get closer in the word.
That's right.
Because if you're not close in the word, it's not going to work out. It's not going to work out. We got to get this word on the inside of us, so much so that it comes out. Like I said a minute ago, out of the Bible says, out of the abundance of the heart, the mouth speaks. When we fill our heart with the word of God, do you know how Jesus defeated Satan when he was tempted in the wilderness? With the word of God.
Right.
He didn't say, wait a minute, what page, what page here, wait a minute, we're not going to have time to do that. When life hits us in the face, and listen, it's going to. We're not going to have time for that. We're going to have to know what the word says. We're going to have to stand up and say, uh-uh, not today, Satan. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. It is written. That's how Jesus defeated him. No weapon formed against me shall prosper. Hallelujah. Amen. It didn't say no weapon formed against me was going to disappear.
That's right.
It said it will prosper. We got to catch things like that. The more we read it, the more we study it, the closer we get to God, the more that'll happen. But let me tell you this. So the story of the woman at the well in John chapter 4, Jesus told her, he said, whosoever drinks of this water shall thirst again, but whosoever drinks of the water that I shall give him shall never thirst, but the water that I shall give him shall be in him, did you hear that? In him, a well of water springing up into everlasting life. And over in chapter 7, he says, out of your bellies shall flow rivers of living water springing up into everlasting life. We got to read this word for ourselves. A lot of times we listen to preachers and we listen to teachers, but listen, God wants us to get in this thing ourselves, because you will see things that you didn't see before, and you will be surprised at what you thought the Bible said. Don't even say. And the things that people say the Bible said, don't even say. That's why we all got to get into this book for ourselves and see what this Bible says. And let it speak to us, and it will. Springing up into everlasting life on the inside. The Bible says that there can be rivers of living water that spring up from the inside. Tanya and I have been doing this for the first 100 days of the year. We've been participating in this. It's called 100 Days of Glory. And it's a 100 days of generosity, 100 days of 100 weeks of prayer, 100 days of prayer, 100 minutes a week, 100 days of Bible reading, 100 days of, what am I leaving out? A whole bunch of stuff we've been doing. So what I'm saying is this, we've been sitting down at night, we've been reading the Bible together, we've been getting our Bible reading done, and the Lord has laid it personally on my heart. We've been taking communion every night for the first 100 days of the year. But I want to tell you something, if you want to find intimate fellowship with God, you sit down with your family at the kitchen table, and listen, you take communion and you pray. I want to tell you, the Holy Ghost can show up at your kitchen table the same as he can at the sanctuary.
Amen.
Okay? And it's been amazing. But we've been reading our Bible together. And you know, one of the things that a lot of times, and I hadn't really caught it until we was reading it. And the Bible says that when God flooded the earth in Genesis, you know, when Noah built the ark, it's that we all know that the rain came down. But also the Bible says that from underneath, waters came up. Fountains of waters come up from underneath. See, the water was already in under the ground, but nobody could see it. The water, the living water, is already inside of here. Whether people see it or they don't see it, it's already in here. And we need to hear the word of God, and we need to pray and lift up each other and exhort each other in such a way that we encourage each other enough to stir that fountain up, to get those rivers to flow, and that when we leave these doors, and I appreciate what Brother Adam said, because, you know, the church, we can come in here and we can say anything we want to inside these four walls. But listen, the church, when it was born, it didn't have a building. They went from house to house, and they went to the streets. Furthermore, Jesus said, go to the highways and hedges and compel them that all my house may be filled. We should come here as our refuel center, as our stirring up center, as our getting our worship on and getting stirred up and getting on fire for God like never before, and helping each other and lifting each other up. Go out into that world and live our lives in a way that pleases God. And you know what? When we see a need in someone, go up to them and pray for them or whatever. Help them, give them something, or whatever it is.
Yes.
That's how we should live our lives.
Amen.
And that's how
Amen.
The kingdom works, and that's how we're going to build it. We have to stop with this, well, they might believe a little different than I do. And, you know, I just don't know if I want to get... Listen, the whole world believes different. I could take an opinion poll just with us here, and everybody else would have probably a different thought on something. But the fact is, we got to love people no matter what they think, no matter what they say, no matter how they act, what they do, where they go. We got to love them. You know why? Because God loves them. And He told us to love them. Anyways. But the rivers of water need to flow from within. It's on the inside of us. And so renewal begins on the inside of us. We don't have to kill ourselves trying to find renewal, trying to find revival, trying to find a refreshing. We don't have to do that, you know, and there's nothing wrong with it. We go to conferences and stuff all the time, but there's nothing, you don't have to drive across the country to find spiritual renewal.
That's right.
Okay? It's in here. And when we pour what's in here out, God will put more in, okay? He will stir us up Himself. He will revive us Himself. But it's good to have brothers and sisters in Christ that we can pray for each other. I'm telling you, you don't know what positive words of encouragement from each other means. It means everything. Okay, I better hurry up. Renewal is not dependent on our circumstances. Now, this is really what I want to drive home, this verse right here. And then I'll probably push. Paul says, but though our outward man perish, yet the inward man is renewed. He says, though the outward man perish, the inward man is renewed. In spite of our physical circumstances, we can still have renewal. What I'm saying is this. Paul had been through a rough time. Okay? He had been left for dead, stoned and left for dead. He had been imprisoned. He had been shipwrecked. He had been beaten. He had been persecuted. He had been through a lot of stuff, you know, and he was still encouraging the church at Corinth to keep on keeping on. You got this. God, the same Spirit that raised Jesus from the dead, the same faith of the Spirit that David had, you got it. And it's on the inside of you, and you can be renewed day by day. Even though you're perishing on the outside, inside, you can have it. That's what he was saying. So what this means is, no matter what is happening on the outside, we got to focus on what God is doing on the inside. That tells me that when you got aches and pains, God can still give you peace and joy in your heart. When all hell is coming loose in your home and it seems like your family's being ripped to shreds by Satan himself, guess what? God will give you a peace that passes all understanding. No matter what comes against you on the outside, whenever, no matter how bad your aches and pains are, no matter what kind of problem you have on the job site, at your workplace, no matter what kind of problem that you have, wherever it is, even within the church, no matter what kind of resistance the devil throws your way, you can still have the peace of God. And the Bible says that the joy of the Lord is our strength. And I want to tell you, it's time that we strengthen up and get our joy back, get our revival back, get our renewal back, get our peace back, and get our song back. Hallelujah. Amen. God has brought me too far to let me go here. And I got a song that we're going to keep on singing, and it's hallelujah. I thank you, Jesus, for letting me see one more day. So no matter what it is on the outside that's coming against you, you can still have it all held together on the inside. And that's another sign of spiritual maturity. I preached a New Year's service, watch night service, and the Lord laid a word on my heart, and it was in John when Jesus said, I am the true vine. And the Lord showed me that He is calling His people, His children, to be a fruitful people. And we're not going to be able to bear the fruit if we're worried about the outside circumstances. I'm talking about outside circumstances when I know the doctor said it don't look good, but I'm still resting in God's hands. Stuff like that's what I'm talking about. I know that this situation don't look good. I'm in a financial bind, but I know that God is the one that provides all my needs according to His riches in Christ Jesus. Hallelujah.
Amen.
That's the kind of mindset we got to have and focus on the inward peace that's on the inside of us. And we have to steer that and renew that from time to time. Because we are going to come into a time when we continue to focus on the things of God, the Holy Spirit, and our renewal, our inner peace. Listen, and we don't give in to Satan, and we don't give in at all when all hell comes against us, and we hold strong, and we stick to the Word, and we are remain faithful, and a faithful people, guess what? You will see it come to pass that eventually the outside circumstances will change to what's on the inside. Because inner renewal starts inner renewal in the inside. When we get renewed inside, the outside will come to pass. It may not, I mean, that's why you can be going through all hell and still have the peace that passes all understanding. Oh. That's why it can be your world can be turned upside down, shaking like a snow globe or something like that. Everything else flying all around. But we can still have the peace of God, knowing everything is all right and knowing that I'm a child of God. And you know what? If it's my time to go, it's my time to go. But you know what? Hey, listen, I'm all about being smart about the virus thing, but we got to stop living in fear, and we got to stop living in our lives in such a way that we bow down to every little threat, every cross word, or every raise of an eyebrow.
Come on. That's right.
That's how we do it. It starts on the inside. And that's how renewal starts, and we need to be renewers. The last thing I want to say is that we're not designed just to receive the renewing ourselves, but as we are renewed, we're designed to be renewers of other people.
Yes.
What I'm saying is this, is that we ought to be speaking life over everybody else.
Right.
And I said that earlier, but I want you to understand that as we focus on speaking life over other people, speaking blessings over other people, speaking encouragement over other people, speaking love over other people, other churches. It's like a water pot. You know the water flower waterer things with the spout and the thing, the hole? It's like one of them. And like, you water it, you put the water in the jug here, and then you pour the water out on everything else all around. Then you go back and you get more water, pour it out all around, pour it out, pour it out. When I do that at our house in the summertime and I'm watering stuff, when I get done, I got water all over my shoes, all down my breeches legs, all in my pockets, all up my arms and everywhere else. What I'm saying is, when we focus on pouring in to other people and other things and other churches and other bodies, we won't even realize it, but we're watering ourselves at the same time. And God is doing just as much of work on us as we're doing on somebody else. He's not, it's not us doing any work, but God wants to work through us to get His will accomplished in their life so they can be encouraged. But anyways, I want to encourage you today to be a renewer. And to be renewed. Because He's making all things new. That's what He said in Revelation chapter 21, verse 5. He that sits on the throne, behold, I make all things new. He makes everything new. Including us. We are to walk in the newness of life. And sometimes we need a little encouragement of that. And a little bit of renewal. But I'm going to turn the service back over to Pastor. But if you're here today, and you have a need, I'll pray for you. I'll be happy to. I'll be happy. Tanya and I both would love the opportunity to pray over your situation, whatever it is, your family, pray over your church, whatever the case is, to speak life over you. I honestly believe with all of my heart, as God has called me to preach at other places and evangelize more and more and more, that this is one of the things that He's asked me to do, and that is simply to speak life over people who are hurting and who are barely hanging on. Listen, we got something to hang on to. I'm telling you, we got something to hang on to. And we have to sometimes just be stirred up on the inside. The New Testament tells us to stir up the gift that's already in here. Because it's easy to grow stagnant and stale. It's easy to get in a routine and in a rut. And we don't do it intentionally sometimes. Sometimes it happens. But whatever it is, I'm going to push it the other way. But. Mm-hmm. Yes, absolutely.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Let's pray. Father, right now, in the name of Jesus, I call on your name. Lord, I thank you for being in this place today, and I thank you for this group of believers that have assembled together. And Lord, I pray, God, for each and every one. I pray, God, for every household that is represented here by one. I pray for every family member. God, I pray for every lost loved one that has a connection by one here today. I pray, God, for your Holy Spirit to go forward from this place as a result of these prayers. I pray for your Spirit, God, to start to convict those that do not know and let them realize that there is more to life than what they have. And as a matter of fact, they don't even know what life even is without you. So God, let your Spirit do the work as only it can do. God, give us the ability to love them, to care for them, and to show love to people that we don't even know, to churches that we don't even know. But with God, I pray, God, that for an anointing just to rest upon this body of believers. And Lord, I pray, God, that every person under the sound of my voice, God, would feel your Holy Spirit in this place today. And I pray for inner renewal in everybody here in this place, God. Stir our hearts and stir those living waters on the inside of us so they may spring forth, God. In times when we don't even think it's going to happen or we don't even realize it, God, we can feel your Spirit working in us and let us receive that today. Lord, I pray, God, for this church. I pray for this group of believers to be able to hold on to your word. And Lord, I'm just listening to your Spirit, God, today. I thank you for speaking to us right now. I thank you, God, for the things that we hear. And Lord, I pray, God, for breakthrough ministries. I hear you say to break out into this world, into this community, into our homes with the gospel of Jesus Christ. And with the power of God, I pray, God, for signs and wonders to follow them that believe that in your name, God, we can do what you call us to do. I pray, God, you could send us where you would have us to go. I pray, God, for signs and wonders to follow this group of believers everywhere we go. God, give us the anointing to go up and lay hands on the sick. And let you work, God, not us, but you work and watch them recover before our very eyes, God. I pray, God, that you would just anoint these singers, anoint this pastor, God. And I pray, God, that as they do your work for your ministry, God, that you would just keep them in the palm of your hand. And as they sing your words, God, I pray for a heavy anointing, God, with every word, so much so that it convicts the lost to come before a Bible is ever even opened, before a sermon is ever even preached, God. I pray, God, for your Holy Spirit just to minister through song, God, as a result of the worship in this place, God, so people could hear that you are calling them, God. You are calling them with your Spirit, Lord. And I pray for salvations to come. I pray, God, again, for your hand just to be upon this group of believers. And I pray for Brother Adam today, God, that you would just anoint him, equip him, God, for stepping out in faith and doing what you have asked him to do. I pray, God, as they go out into this community, God, that people would take note. And I pray, God, that put the devil on notice that his time is limited and that the children of God are going to be more and more. And Satan, you're going to have to turn loose because the power of God is greater than anything that you may try to throw at us, Satan. So, Lord, we claim the power of God over this pastor and over this congregation, Lord. I pray, God, that as they go out these doors, that they would be more stirred up, even more than they are inside these doors, God. And Lord, I pray that your name would be preached, your gospel would be preached, and your name would be exalted out there more than it is in here, God. And let us just be a refueling center, Lord. Your word teaches us that iron sharpens iron, God. And so again, I speak life over this group of believers in this house today. I speak life over this church body. I speak life over the longevity of this church as an organization, God, to be a witness for you and your glory, God. I pray, God, for testimonies to start coming in one by one by one. testimonies of your healing power, testimonies of your salvation, testimonies of setting the addiction, breaking those chains and those bondages, God, breaking that addict cycle, God. And Lord, I pray, God, for new converts to come. I pray, God, for new life over this church and new things to take place in this ministry. And I pray, God, that we would all be renewed today by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, I pray, God, if there's any here today that is uncertain about their relationship with you, I pray, God, that the Holy Ghost would bring that to light, reveal that to them, that they may bring it to you, God. I thank you, God, that you are faithful and just to forgive us. I thank you, God, that you love us more than we could even understand what the word love means, God. I'm thankful, God, that you are here in this place. And God, move in our midst. We love you, Lord. I praise you, Lord. And I thank you for this opportunity to come and minister on your behalf. And I pray this today in Jesus' name. Amen.
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 Does the senator have a testimony? Do you have a testimony?
Not me.
They're going to come up and sing a song. I think it's kind of a teen song that goes through. It's Amazing Grace, My Chains Are Gone.
And, yes.
Brother said that both of you would be willing to pray for anybody in that.
Absolutely.
Me as well, as far as that goes. If you need prayer whatsoever, just come up here. We'll pray for you, however that goes. But I'm just going to, you all just sing a song and just let Holy Spirit roll in. Everyone stand if you can.
My God, my God. Amazing grace.
The harvest is truly beautiful today. And God, I pray, God, as He leads this congregation, God, that You would separate
shipment of 500 copies on Friday, so I've got a lot to work with right now.
Amen.
I've donated almost 1,325 copies since I started.
Amen.
Awesome. Amen.
Amen. Amen. Thank you, Jesus.
Awesome to be back in church today.
Yes.
Amen.
Anyone else? Yes.
We were doing a lumber business delivery, and since we ate out, you know, had a restaurant supper. It was really late, so there was not a whole lot going on in there. And it was just kind of us and this one other table, of people gathered. And this one man just started having a fit, and so this happens fast. But I don't know. He's up. He's leaning over another table. He's squalling off. I put him. And so, you know, my immediate response is like, all right, I'll pray for this guy. And then I realized, I'm not so sure I'm up to this, interrupting his husband, comforting him, to try to get in the mix. And I was like, I'm about to die, just I don't know about it. For that kind of deliverance at this moment. I could eat my chicken and feel funny about it. And anyway, so we put our stuff in the truck, and I still couldn't shake it, and I was like, hey, I'll be back. And they kind of followed us out, basically. So I met the man back again at the entrance. And to my shock and, you know, delight, I just like, you know, what can I pray for you? What's going on with him? He's like, it's still hot. So I'm having some sort of stab in my back, and I'm just like, I'm ready to get out of here because I can't bear it. And I said, yeah, I pray for you. And he just shone. He was so relieved and so excited. And he's turning for me to put my hand on him and stuff. I'm like, whoo! And so anyway, yeah, just immediately, you know, put my hand on him and just rebuked it. And he was, I don't know how he was that surprised. I mean, he was obviously enthusiastic. He knew something. And the pain just immediately left it totally ended.
Praise
and
God.
Just straightened right up. And he was like, that was amazing. So I just looked in the eye and said, because Jesus loves you. He did that because He loves you. He's like,
amen.
He looked me dead in the eye, bright eyes. Yes, He does. Yes, He does. That is true. He just showed that is right. Yes, He does.
Amen.
And then immediately starts telling the people who are coming out behind him, that's what just happened. I go back to the truck, but I just blessed my socks off. And was, you know, humbling.
Just wonderful. I don't know how we get stuck in our head about hesitations to just go with sharing His love.
Yes.
Amen. Amen. You never know where He's going to show up and what He's going to do. Amen.
Amen.
Anyone else? Well, I praise God for the message today.
Yes.
Yes. Very powerful, very anointed in that. And as He said about it being in here, God said about it being in here, if you did not feel the Holy Spirit in that message, I don't know how you.
Yeah, I've got testimonies, but it'll be after the video ends.
Gotcha. Go ahead and take care of that, Tim. That way she can go ahead and do that. Love you all on YouTube. Share, like, all that stuff. We'll see you soon. God bless you.